Dogs on BCTV is supported by the Berks County Kennel Club and by the Berks County Dog Training Club.
Good evening and welcome to the Berks County Dog Training Club's program, All About Dogs. Hi, I'm Pat Mock, your host, and this evening we're going to be talking about agility, but agility with small dogs. Now, you all know what I'm talking about when I say agility. You've all watched it on television, but let me tell you, going to see it in person and watching it on television are two totally different things, just like watching a football game on television or being there live. It's much more exciting to see it in person. But anyway, my guests this evening are Cindy and Vince Medeiros, and they are very active in agility. And they're going to tell us how it's different to train a small dog in agility as opposed to a larger dog in agility. I would assume that some of the exercises are easier for a small dog, like the weave poles. I'm thinking of the weave poles for a small dog to get through it, rather than, you know, your big German Shepherd, Golden Retriever kind of dogs.
Yes, yeah. It's largely based on, obviously, the size of the dog and the timing.
Mm-hmm.
And a lot of it is, you know, based on the drive of the dog, too. So some of the bigger dogs have slower drive. Some of the smaller dogs have a faster drive.
Okay.
So it can vary, but generally the smaller dogs do have an easier time getting their bodies to fit through that opening.
Right, right. But then again, as opposed to the weave poles, the teeter.
Correct.
Where they have the small dog has to bring that teeter down, and you know, you got a 3-pound dog, and it's all the way down at the end, and it's still not tilting, you know?
That's right. Yes.
Now, you're training, this is your new puppy.
Yes, she's 21 months old.
Okay.
And she's been to now 4 trials.
Oh, really?
So, okay. Getting more and more confidence each time.
Yeah, so you are running her now?
Yes.
Is there a specific age with a small dog when you sort of start them out? I know you, a larger dog, you shouldn't have jumping before they're a year, some of them even 18 months, because it's too hard on their joints. Do you have that same problem with a small dog?
It basically is, you do what we call a foundation training.
Okay.
And basically the foundation training doesn't require any type of obstacles of any concern for any of those type of issues. So a lot of it is going to be based on the foundation stuff is basically getting the dog to play, interact, relationship building, those type of things that we do.
Okay.
We do some bend work with them, teaching them to turn and to bend, not lots of repetition,
mm-hmm.
but pretty much, you know, a lot of it is, you know, learning to sit and stay, waiting patiently for a release,
okay.
start lines,
mm-hmm.
And then later as they start to graduate towards the next level, where they're competent in those elements,
mm-hmm.
then we start adding those things, the smaller type, what we call the kindergarten sort of play things with them. And we have a video that will show some of the stuff
okay.
we did with Gucci
okay.
To help perform that. And you can see the progression as she started out. We started her out when basically the day we got her just with teaching her to play, teaching
mm-hmm.
her to interact,
mm-hmm.
teaching her to bring toys and return to us rather than trying to keep away from us.
Right. And when, you know, you're talking about agility, people don't even think about things like that, you know.
Correct.
Playing. What do you mean? Why do
yes.
they need to learn how to play? They
right.
need to run the course.
Correct.
Not play.
Correct.
But as far as they're concerned, running the course is play.
Is play. And that's
exactly.
and that's what we try to transfer that behavior to being, is that agility is play.
Right.
So it becomes all one sort of event. We play, we run the course, we have a good time. And that's how we try and, you know, train the dogs to accept the ability to do it, is that it is purely play.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Right. And that gets them all excited when they Correct. Get there.
Correct.
Because they are excited when
right.
they get there.
If you really look at the dogs that are really into it,
mm-hmm.
They are having a great time. It's
right.
it's a lot of fun. They get excited. And most of the times when we have people that come to our classes and so forth, as they're driving up our driveway, they said the dogs get excited. You know,
mm-hmm.
they're ready for the energy
right, right,
outlet.
Right, right. It's fun for a dog to jump.
Yeah.
It is.
They love the jump. It's
Correct.
It's part of the dog.
It
and
is.
And talking about jumping, you know, you were asking
uh-huh.
about the big dogs versus the little dogs. in each case, both for the little dogs and the big dogs, we start with pulls on the ground going through the wings. But we do raise them a little bit sooner with the smaller dogs.
Okay.
But not by much.
Right.
It's not about jumping. It's about learning the skill to go
required to jump.
Exactly.
Yes, right. So.
And also creating value for the obstacle. Mm-hmm. And that's the big thing as well. A lot of times, all of our reinforcement happens close. So if we do the sits, all that happens close. When we try and train agility, we also teach the dog to work away a little bit.
Right.
So when you think about doing agility, for the most part, your dog is operating maybe 3 to 10 feet away from you. Most of the time.
That's exactly right, because you certainly aren't jumping with them.
Correct.
Right.
So that's a skill that they have to learn at a young age. So mm-hmm. we use things like going around a cone, sending the dog around a cone, distance work. And we teach value for that, and then that is a lot easier transferred to the obstacles later on. So we have a transfer factor that is already trained when they're babies.
Right. So when you use you're using the words value. What do you use? As value. Does it,
you can
does
use
it
food, you
dogs?
Can use toys. Yeah, it depends on the dog, the dog, the motivation of the dog. Some dogs are more toy motivated, some dogs are more food motivated.
Yes, okay.
In which case then we use things like a Lotus ball or something, a food type bag that we throw so the dog is going to it.
Okay, what is a Lotus ball?
A Lotus ball is basically a little ball that, like a lotus flower, it opens up and the food is inside.
Okay.
It's a training tool we use. Uh-huh. You can stick it in your pocket so you always have it ready and you can lob it when you need to. And what it does, it creates a place to be reinforced rather than always next to the handler.
Yes.
So if I'm doing some distance work, i.e. like around a cone or something like that, sending mm-hmm. my dog around the cone, I can reinforce the far side of the cone.
Okay.
When the dog commits to going.
Okay. So then the dog is getting the reward out there, being away from you rather than racing into you to have to race out again.
Correct.
Right.
Yes.
Okay.
So that's a lot of the techniques that we use with the babies. And what happens is that, you know, once we get these things, like I said, learned to, a high percentage of predictability, mm-hmm. then we can start moving to the next level. And that's where you know you're ready to, you know, to go to the next platform. And then we start adding things like, you know, a dog walk that may be at a very low level.
Okay.
Like, you know, maybe a foot off the ground, mm-hmm. just mm-hmm. get them to mm-hmm. stay on that and go from one end to the other. So we're concentrating on transferring value for being on stuff, going through stuff, so tunnels, A-frames, dog walks, those type of things are done like at an extremely low level.
Mm-hmm. And I would guess that teaching them to go through a tunnel would be difficult because it's like they can't see you. They don't know
Correct.
What's in there.
Yeah, and there again, there's a value sort of attached to that in the beginning, and you know, there takes maybe 2 or 3 people to operate that process. We shrink the tunnel down to like a nothing size, and we usually get the handler or the owner on the other side begging the dog to come through with cookies or toys. And once they come through, you know, if there's any trauma that's involved in like, I can't go through this tunnel, it's usually over by the second round, and they go, I'm coming through. Yeah, so it's a lot of fun for the dogs, and like I said, they love to do that. They love the game, and if you start promoting it at that level, then it's easy for them to move forward with interest. Yeah.
Yeah. So is it more difficult, like you said, you started training her the day you brought her home.
Right. Yep.
But you were training for, you already knew you
correct.
Wanted to compete with her.
That's correct.
But for just like the everyday person,
right.
if their dog is now 2 or 3 years old, would it be feasible for them to even start, or is it already too late for them to start?
No, it is, like I said, it's dependent on the dog, and usually I get people that come and contact me when the dog has too much energy.
Okay.
And they want to know what to do with it. And that's usually a sign. And then, you know, they've usually seen the sport somewhere on TV or maybe gone to a trial or something like that or gone to an event. And they, you know, they just want to do something with their dog, especially a very active dog. In those cases, it's not as difficult to teach them because then you're just teaching them operant conditioning. We're just conditioning the dog to become operant in that environment.
Right.
And then it's just one of those things, step by step, moving forward.
Okay. So we do have a video of you teaching her right at the start.
Correct.
Can we see that first video? We're going to see Gucci do some work.
Thank you.
Oh, okay.
So this is for, these are the dogs actually come competing.
Oh, okay, okay. Yeah, I see it. It's Flirt. It's the
brown. That one's Flirt, yes.
Yeah, that is Flirt. She's at a competition.
That's a long way away she is, isn't
it
she?
It is, yeah. So yeah, you can see the distances that they're operating from. Here's the weed pole she's going through. Cindy's running ahead.
This is Gucci.
This is Gucci's first run in agility.
Okay. Oh, wow. Well, she has a good sit-stay.
She does.
She does.
Even with the distraction of the toy.
Yep.
So there she goes up the A-frame.
Oh, she's a speedy little son of a gun, isn't she?
She is. She's very quick, and she loves the game as well. Uh-huh. You can see her in the weed pole. She's going through the weed poles right now. And then I jump up to the dog walk. So this is her finished product of the dog walk. So you'll see in one of the other videos where we were teaching her to go full length on the dog walk.
Okay. And she's so far away, you don't even know there's a dog there.
There you go. She was able to tip the teeter down. She came further.
Okay.
There you go.
As she goes through the tunnel, look at her.
Yes. All right. So it's fun, and I love that, you know, when we talk about agility.
Uh-huh.
It is just that for the dogs. You can see they're all very exuberant about doing the sport. We have a great camaraderie with our friends, that our fellow competitors.
Uh-huh, uh-huh.
And everybody's cheering for everybody else, and that's
trying
the real name of the game.
Trying
to help everybody else out, and everybody supports everybody. So it's a great sport to be in.
And it's actually you and the dog. It's
correct.
Not, you know, that it's correct. It's so competitive, like, you know, that like the breed ring. You know,
correct.
Like when you
it's
when you show different. In confirmation, it's so, you know, the judge has, you know, his idea, and, you know, that's how the dog is handled, and the whole bit, whereas, you know, in agility, hey, if your dog misses, it misses, and you blew it.
Yeah, there's nothing subjective about you either do it or you don't.
That's exactly
and
right.
That's
you
the,
do it
that's
or you
a
don't.
Real big difference. I mean, the only things that, you know, that could be a little bit tweaky on the calls is that, like, if you missed a contact or something like that.
Mm-hmm.
You know, my dog
mm-hmm.
had a paw on it, and the judge didn't see it. But those are normal things that you're going to get. But for the most part, it's you and your dog against the course.
That's exactly right.
And it is a timed event. So, you know, that is why you go out there and you put so much effort into it, is because you really want to beat the time. You want to do well on the course. And then you have the different levels, you know, so not everybody's running at that level of competition. So you do have a starters and then, you know, the next level, and then you have a master's level. So you have a starters, then an advanced, and then a master's level. Each level is tiered to be another degree of difficulty. So,
do they do, when you say a starters level, do they do the same equipment?
They do. What the main difference in the three different levels of competition in that is that the approaches are a lot easier. The lines are maybe a little bit kinder, whereas in the higher levels, the approaches are maybe a little bit tighter. Plus, you may have what we call a trap or an off course sort of thing.
Okay, so we don't understand that, what that is.
Yeah. So if you're jumping a jog over a jump and you have a tunnel at the end of the jump, it may not be the tunnel. It may be the jump that's not directly in front of
okay,
you.
Oh, okay.
And
then
you can get a wrong
more
advanced.
Correct. So the dog has to be paying attention,
so the dog
basically,
has to
in the more advanced classes.
Correct. Yeah. So the dog has to learn discrimination.
Okay.
So what to do, you know, in that thing, to come with the handler, not just go to the obvious obstacle.
Right.
So those are the levels that you get as you start to move up.
But in the starters, they'd have almost everything like in a straight line or basically around a
it's
circle.
It's sort of a curvy type thing.
Yes, or a big S.
Okay. So it's like I said, the angles are a little bit more kinder.
Okay.
For the dog and the handler.
Probably especially for the handler.
Especially for the handler, yes. Definitely.
Especially if you're just starting out. It's like, oh my God, I can't do this. Yeah, she did a really good job. And that
she
was
did.
That a starter's course that you did with her then?
That was, yes. That was in UKI.
Okay.
So just started recently doing that.
I what is UKI?
United Kingdom International. It's another, it's a European organization that does the agility here as well.
So it's, okay.
It's like AKC.
Okay,
USDA.
So then there's more than there's just more AKC that
correct.
You can do.
Yes, there's AKC, there's USDA, CPE, there's quite a few
wow.
out there.
Wow.
Yes. So yeah, there's lots of organizations out there, and you know they're sort of they have their own little niche for the people that want to operate at that level.
Okay.
So you know I would consider myself UKI and USDAA to be more along the world level operating point. You know, for like world term people, that type of thing, where you really want to get into sort of like a U.S. team, that type of thing, to represent overseas.
So European flair.
So okay. it does have the degree of difficulty is I think a little bit harder.
Okay.
Yeah.
So then it's almost easier to do the AKC courses?
No, it has its own difficulty level.
They have the same equipment though, right?
They have similar equipment.
Similar equipment.
For instance, like they have a dog walk, but the contact zone is 6 inches longer than USDAA.
So there are
things that are a little bit different like that.
Okay.
So that's just one of the differences.
Okay. So the dog doesn't really need to learn any additional skills.
Right.
Correct.
Everything they learned in the beginning is the same thing.
You could easily do both.
With AKC, there's a table. The mm-hmm. dog just has to get on the table and it's positionless.
Okay.
In USDA, the dog has to get on the table and go down.
Oh, okay.
So
that adds another degree, in my mind, that another
of
degree
difficulty.
Of difficulty because
yes.
now the dog's in a heightened arousal state.
Yes.
And now you're asking it to drop or
right.
go down.
And stay there, yeah.
And stay
yes.
there for mm-hmm. for a five count.
Right.
So those are things that that you know are different, similar but different. So
that's
the big takeaway from
okay. that. Okay. Well, let's watch the next video, whichever one that may be.
Yeah. So this is the
okay. This is the large
the,
dog.
The large
this
dog.
Is a larger dog.
And you can see from how you know how many strides he takes in comparison to when you saw the video of
Richie. Right. Yes.
So he's covering a lot more ground quicker.
Right.
And you'll see on this he has a 2-1-2 off. He has a stop at the bottom of the
okay.
A-frame.
Yeah, that
which
was good.
Will, yeah. So we worked hard on that because
you did it two times.
Yes, 2 A-frames in that one. That's just super safe. He's very
obviously
excited.
He's done. Yeah.
He's very excited.
Yeah, very good, very good. Yeah. So then it really is. You can definitely see the difference between the
yes.
large dog and the small dog.
Yes.
Yes.
Even though she was very speedy.
Yes.
Well, they were both very speedy, but
yes.
you know, you can see that he's covering way more ground.
Correct.
So
correct.
do they have like a different time
yes.
limit for the big dogs as opposed to the small dogs?
Yes.
I'm assuming it's according to height. I can't imagine that they would be jumping the same height as
correct.
A big dog.
That's correct. What they basically do is they will, what we call, wheel the course with a measuring wheel.
Okay.
A rolling measuring wheel.
Uh-huh.
And how they figure it out, they have a formula that's based on yards per second. And that
okay.
that formula is based on the height of the dog and what the average height of that dog will cover yards per second. And then
then
they will figure out how much time the dog is allowed on that course or what class that dog is allowed to cover. So in other words, for like the 12-inch dogs, 12 to 16-inch dogs, they may get like 45 seconds to cover the course.
Mm-hmm.
For the larger dogs, they will probably get like maybe 40 seconds to cover the course. So there could be a five-second spread between the big and the small dogs.
Right. And you say 5 seconds like it's so long.
Yes. But that sometimes, and because of the electronic timing devices that we now use, it is fractions of a second that sometimes you're over or under by.
Wow.
Yeah.
So
really.
It's become very precise in, you know, measuring the time from the time the dog takes off to the time the dog lands across
mm-hmm,
the jump.
Mm-hmm.
And like I said, you know, it's all very calculated on how this is done. So it's not at all by chance.
Right. So and with the judges, it's not really subjective on their part at all.
Correct.
They
are judging the dog's performance on that particular obstacle at that time. There is no, you should have turned left instead of right.
They're
judging the performance.
So you do your own thing.
You do your own thing. Not everybody has to run the same course. You could do a front cross rather than a rear. All those other moves you can do.
Okay.
So you can manipulate the course the way you want to. You just have to make sure that the sequencing is correct.
You follow the numbers.
Follow the numbers.
Yes, there are numbers on everything, right?
Yes, that's right.
But now, even with the big dogs, you would go through the same basic training techniques as you would with the small dogs?
Yes. One of the things that most people don't take into consideration is that, a lot of the turnings that we do with our dogs requires collection. So it's not about just running fast, but it's cueing the dog to turn with collection.
Okay.
Otherwise, what happens is that the dog jumps long, there's no turning, there's obstacles that will come into play that you don't mean to.
Okay.
So pretty much that is one of the things we do with the bigger dogs. Not as much with the smaller dogs, because most of them can collect because they have, for every 5 strides of a little dog, it's 2 strides for a bigger dog.
Right.
So if you take that and you equate that to a turning radius, then the dog must start to turn at 1.5 strides, and the other dog can start to turn at at
so
a different rate.
So when you say collecting, you want the dog to sort of slow down and get control of its body.
Correct. So you're adding a stride in. So if you have like a 10-foot span, as an example, and you want the dog to continue forward, usually that dog can, what we call, do 2 strides between that 10-foot span.
Right.
If you want the dog to turn, the dog must add another stride to collect.
Okay.
So 3 strides
okay.
would be required to make a turning, or maybe 4, depending on the dog. That will vary. So that's what we try and teach the larger dogs, is to collect.
Okay, okay.
That's a little different from the smaller dogs.
Yeah, from the smaller dogs, yes. Yeah. So what you're saying, it's easier with a smaller dog than a bigger dog.
It can be. We have some pretty quick little small dogs that
I can imagine.
That have a hard time turning too.
If they're going too fast,
that's right. That's right.
Yeah. Well, thank you very much. I think we covered pretty much here this evening, didn't we?
We did.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah. So it's a fun sport for the dogs.
It is.
Absolutely.
It's great
for the people too.
Yeah,
it's great exercise for the people as well.
Yes.
Great exercise. It is a great brain stimulator as well, because you got to think about things. It's not as easy, to make those things happen in a short period of time.
That's exactly right. All you got to do is follow the numbers.
The numbers.
And not trip over something.
Yes. Yeah. That's the other thing. There's been a few of those.
We won't talk about that, will we?
No, we won't talk about that. The clumsy handlers will let those out of it.
That's for sure.
But very good. Well, thank you very much for being on the program.
Thank you.
So thank you for having
any
us.
Any dog can do this.
Any dog can do this.
Right.
And even if you just want to do it for fun, it's a great way to just go out there. You haven't got to go into competition mode. Just come out, enjoy it. It is what I call freestyle obedience. And the dogs are learning stuff. They are learning to, to respond to handler's requests.
Right, right.
So it is obedience in a sense, but it's just very fast.
Yes, yes, yes. And a lot of dogs don't have that obedience either.
Correct.
Which, all dogs need some kind of obedience.
That's right.
And that's a nice, easy way to learn it.
Yeah.
So, well, I thank you again.
Okay. Well, thank you for having us.
Sure,
thank you.
Sure.
We enjoyed the visit.
Yes, we did. We did a lot of talking in
a
little bit of time.
We did do a lot of talking.
Yes, we did.
So you all learned all about agility and how to train your dogs. It's fun. It's great exercise for the dog. It's great exercise for you. So, hey, give it a try. Just call the Berks County Dog Training Club or go on their website, berksdogtraining.com, and they can give you all the information about going to classes and how you can get started with your dog, especially if you have an active dog. So next month, I'm not quite sure what we'll be having, but for this evening, good night.
Dogs on BCTV is supported by the Berks County Kennel Club and by the Berks County Dog Training Club.